So the last problem of these lectures I want to mention a bit about optical lattices. So by using light, interfering light in the opposite direction, for instance, one like this, and the other going from this direction, you form some interference pattern in the forms of such planes of large or small intensity. And you see that this way, when you put atoms there, you create such a periodic potential in one direction, the other is free. But if you add another two beams, or maybe I would add it from this side, but better for the problem. Then you divide this field into such one dimensional. Then finally, when you put additional from the top and the bottom, you make a 3D periodic structure. So you can form by arranging geometry of several interfering light beams, you can produce, arrange the shape of the periodic potential, and you can put atoms there. Sometimes you form PEC first and then on this PEC you form this periodic lattice and then the atoms are trapped. They are trapped and then you have some periodic arrangement. So this way, it was the lecture I think that Wolfgang Ketterle was advocating for this subject was atomic physics, means condensed matter physics. Finally, people achieve the situation as you have in condensed matter, you have periodic structure and you have quantum particles moving in this periodic structure. You see that it really changed the atomic physics totally. From something like spectroscopy or some one atom problems that you can study, interaction of atom with light, you come to problems which were domain of condensed matter. In a condensed matter systems, you have electrons in the periodic lattice. And even the uncharacteristic energy of quantum degeneracy of electrons, which are very light objects, is very large as compared to the energy related to the room temperature. I think it is, I don't know, Fermi temperature is a few thousand kelvins for electrons. So already the room temperature, when you put you have a piece of condensed matter, you have to use quantum mechanics. With atoms, it is really a long way. In order to say that motional states of atom, not its internal structure, but motional state is quantized, and you have to use quantum mechanics to describe the transport of atoms through some medium, it was really a very difficult experimental work of cooling these atoms to this temperature and then developing ways of manipulating them. Manipulating with atoms opens new possibilities as the atoms have internal structure. They have internal structure, there are lasers, they interact with light, therefore there is a rich variety of doing a lot of things with atoms which was not possible to do with electrons. Therefore, it is not only repeating what was done with electrons, but also discovering new unexplored areas of quantum many-body physics. So that's why the atomic physics is right now. Very often we meet with criticism of condensed matter physicists, but what you have done, in fact, you repeat what was done and you show that you have the same as was obtained then. It is in some sense true, but on the other hand it is not true because there are totally different means. If you have the same same system and Feynman wrote the same equation has the same solutions, and so if you find a system which is described by the same Hamiltonian, obviously you have the same solutions. However, this is different system, different range of parameters with different means of observation and different means of manipulation. Therefore, you have access to something that you don't have access in condensed matter. For instance, you can photograph atoms and you can see them. You cannot do it with electrons. You can manipulate some parameters in time. And very often in condensed matter, in order to have different parameters of the lattice, you have to prepare different samples. You cannot change it back and forth and so on. So I think it is very useful to do the same physics on different systems, even if at some moment you think that you are repeating, but you can simulate a lot of known systems, and it is always to simulate that. It is, I think that you agree that it is useful to simulate a plane, not to crash it in plane, but to have something which is simulated and you learn a lot. So with this field, which opened something which is called quantum simulator, that you have flexible system, and on this system, by having external lobes, you can simulate different Hamiltonians in a really large variety of different Hamiltonians. So it is very useful, I think. So it is a big progress, and it really changed the atomic physics. You know, all this correlated system. So it is really at the front of, I think, physics right now, this kind of investigations. So I think the seminal experiment, which started this experiment of, okay, Emanuel Bloch, but the first author was Markus Greiner, who was a student at this time. I don't know if he was a PhD student, I think PhD student, and the group of Professor Theodor Hensch in Garching in Munich. And it was observation of Mott insulator superfluid transition. I want to give you the real title. Okay, I will try to find the title of this paper. Quantum phase transition. This is a seminal paper. So I should put it. Quantum phase transition. From a superfluid. Such a potential, you put atoms there. And then, I'm not going to describe them in details, you have to write down the Hamiltonian of the system, how to do it. You know that in the trap you have the Gross-Pitayski equation. But for such a periodic system, the standard description of such periodic system is first to find the eigenstate, one part, to solve the single particle problem. In a single particle problem, find the natural one-particle basis, and you know that these are Bloch states. You have the periodic system, you have Bloch states. And then the tight piping approximation, when you assume that the atoms are localized, so you have this small traps, I will call them lattice sites, and then you can form superposition of such Bloch waves, which is localized in an individual site, which is called the Vanier function. So we will be using the Vanier functions. We don't have time for details. It should be done in the case of this interference lies and the potential is sine squared, you can do it really analytically to a large extent. So you use the basis of Vanier wave functions, which are localized at given, so this is Vanier function R minus RI, where I will be the index denoting the individual lattice site, and these functions are localized and they vanish exponentially at large distance. This from I don't know if I wrote it correctly, sometimes people try to approximate it by Gaussian, but it definitely takes a wrong, it's not the best way. So these are the Vanier functions, and then the field operator for bosons can be expanded in this basis. Okay. When we have one site, we have discrete quantum levels. Yes. And when we have two, these levels are split into two. Okay. If we have the first one, there will be the additional splitting, and so on. Finally, you get into the concept of bands. Okay. If the trap are very tight, very often we will limit our attention to the ground state, to this Vanier state, corresponding to this lowest band. Okay. So because otherwise I should add here a summation over bands. So it will be the lowest Vanier state, R minus R prime. We have at every lattice site we have such a Vanier state. And then we have annihilation operator of particle at the given site. And then if we put it into the many-body Hamiltonian, which is the same one as we used to describe the Gross-Pitayski equation, you will get something which is called, I'm not going to, because it is very simple, so I'm not going to derive the Hamiltonian of the system, but the strategy is that you have this original Hamiltonian, which is slightly darker, single particle Hamiltonian, plus local interaction. So if you substitute this into this Hamiltonian and you will try to do some approximations, you will assume that interaction is local, you will arrive at Bose Hubble.
Energy U, because we sample, so it is I I know this is low, but if we have dipole interactions, evidently you see some potential to have density, number of atoms at site I times number of atoms at some j. And then there is this guy which gives non-vanishing element between the distant lattice sites. Because it is gradient, so it is easy to see that this is doesn't have to be necessarily local. And typically what people do is to introduce to nearest neighbors. And I will say that this is sum over ij, whatever. This must indicate that I am summing over nearest neighbors. And here I should have some probability of jumping from site I to site j. Plus complex conjugate, something might come to this site from site j, which is neighbor of I. Okay? First of all, you can recognize that the Hamiltonian is written by atomic physicists. How you can recognize it? Because of this J. What people in condensed matter do is they teach us we shouldn't use J, because J is used for something different. It should be small t as a transition element. But we use t for die, but now atomic physics are slowly changing to the notation, maybe not slowly. Some of them are using t, some j, but historically I think it was this j. So I want to say that there are two limiting cases for this lattice one model. First, I will set this energy to zero. So because this is a single particle energy, I can use the zero energy to scale it to zero. Okay? So I will remove it. Unless I would like to have different energy, for instance, to study Anderson localization and have some random potential, then I could keep. But then, zero, one particle zero can be everywhere. So I will remove this. So, in this case, I will divide it by U as the unit of energy, and you see that the model has one parameter only. It is ratio of probability of jumping to the another site divided to the contact interaction energy on an individual site. Whatever what we, there are two opposite cases. We have different ground state solution. Let us assume, for instance, that J is on zero. If J is zero, okay, you can see how particles will distribute over the lattice. Evidently, they want to minimize this energy, so they want to distribute evenly the lattice. So, if number of lattice sites, this is number of sites and number of atoms . So if we divide m over m would be number of atoms per site . Yes . So if it is integer they want to split evenly to be the same number of atoms at a single site . This minimizes the interaction. So if this energy dominates, the atoms sit in the lattice site. They evenly distribute them on each side and they don't jump because it is the minimum energy. In the opposite case, when this dominates, okay, there is large contribution to the energy which is negative. The ground state one here is negative, the P wave is positive. So when this gives a big contribution, we decrease slightly energy. So in the first case, we have a mod state, insulating state, which is possible only with integer occupations. Because if there is no integer, there is always some atoms which are left, which jump, okay? And that's, you have to live with it. So mod insulator, the state where you have at every atom site, you know, you have, so it is a product, you have a given number of, so you have AI, which is NI, okay, acting on a vacuum, okay, and then you have product over all sides, but if you have you create atom on a side to power n. Okay?
Yes?
You have exactly n atoms and you have a product. So this is ground state, this is proportional to this.
And this is insulating phase. There are no fluctuations of atom per side.
And then there is another possibility. You will get the largest possible minimum energy if the atom is everywhere on the lattice. So you create atom, you sum over all atom lattice sites, AI, probably you have to normalize it. So this is the one atom created in the superposition of I equal 1, I equal 2, I equal 3, I equal blah 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 states. So atom is evenly distributed over entire space, and then you have n atoms. And then you have n atoms all together. Yes. So this is the ground state, and this state is mod, and this is superfluid. This is superfluid. Okay. So there are two opposite cases, and everything depends on the parameter J over U is the only parameter of this Hamiltonian. The only parameter in this Hamiltonian. So, if U dominates, so if this is very small, we have mod. And then, when large, at some moment you have quantum phase transition. At zero temperature, phase transition between the two different ground states of the Hamiltonian, two different phases, and these are quantum fluctuations who are driving this transition. They are not thermal fluctuations, but quantum fluctuations, which something has to initiate this transition, and the system will recognize that it wants to be in the superfluid phase. So there are two phases, mod insulator, and the one is insulating obviously because particles wants to minimize the interaction energy, and the second is superfluid because the particles wants to minimize the energy which is related to the jumping from side to side, and there are large fluctuations of particle number in this case when they are jumping. And how we can, and look what is the potential, the real potential, these parameters I and J and U are related to the external potential. External potential of two interfering is proportional to tau zero sine squared, I think, K times X. Okay? So it has, it is like this. Is proportional to intensity of two interfering. And this phi zero is this depth of this potential. So if you have this Vanier function, then in order to find this U, you have to have a product of four Vanier functions at one side, because that will be integrated. This will be, U will be proportional to the integral of Vanier function to power 4, which depends on, for fixed wavelengths, which depends on phi zero. You can imagine that the larger the height of the potential, the Vanier functions are better localized, and this U is really very big. Yes, particles are really, they can be spread over small distance. If you approximate this by some parabola here, you will have larger and larger density. That's why this U will grow. On the other hand, this J is nothing else like this P squared over 2m between these two wave functions. This is like this. And of course, it depends on the overlap of these two guys. Of course, the larger the height of the potential barrier, the smaller, and therefore J is smaller. And when you see that manipulating the light intensity, you can change the depth of the potential, and this way you can affect this parameter of the model. So the idea of experiment was put these atoms into such lattice, okay? Start with very deep lattice, then you have mod phase, and then you change the intensity of the light to lower the potential, and then out of a sudden you should go to the mod phase, dynamically, which is not possible. And how to observe it? The idea was simple. Just open the lattice and look at the interference picture. What do you expect from the interference picture when you have particles well localized in the lattice, in the side? Do you expect any rich interference structure where particles are well localized? There is no any overlap, there are no any relative phases which are fixed by anything. Therefore, what you see is Fourier transform of the Vanier function. Okay? So therefore, the mod insulator, in the expansion, you see something which is large intensity here. This is multiplied by the number of lattices. However, when you have superfluid phase, you have very nice interference pattern. And because this global wave function, which appears has nice modulations with period of 2k, because if this is k, sine squared is 2k, therefore you see very nice, I don't know how many of these guys are there, you see very nice interference structure here. For superfluids, they jump from side to the side, they are able to establish a common phase, and so there is phase coherent system over entire lattice, and you see beautiful experiment. And really, at the lattice side, about 13 recall energies, they see this phase transition. If they go on, they started with 13, I think they could go to something less, whatever, okay? And then you see totally different interference structure. Whatever, they can wrap the lattice back. Then they see that nothing changes, and they've been able even to notice how long does it take to establish coherence, because they can open it at a different time after wrapping the lattice below the phase transition, for instance, to the superfluid phase. And this is just the time which is needed for single atom tunnel to the neighboring side when you have full coherence for the entire lattice. So it was really the seminal experiment. I have nice calculations of the phase diagram, but I will not present it now because it's too long. So I will show what is the phase diagram and explain it. However, I had the idea that I will do something that your lecture should do to derive the phase diagram in the full glory for mod insulator transition. But this lecture is really special, as I wanted to go quickly over the topics that are important. So typically, we plot this phase diagram in the plane of J over U in chemical potential. Why chemical potential? Because typically in the mixing calculation you break the conservation of energy. And in fact, you look for such situation when the mean field of annihilation operator is not zero. Okay, it is some complex number. For the system with translational symmetry, you don't expect that this depends on psi. Okay, that there is this mean field which appears. When you have the superfluid, it means there is some order parameter, this mean field wave function which appears over the lattice, and in order to do this, you break symmetry. geometry, so you consider the Hamiltonian, which was the original one minus mu times n. Okay? Just to fix the mu to keep the constant number of particles. The phase diagram looks like this.
Like this,
So this motor region you can enter only with n equal 1, and then you are here. And you can change it, and you are still, okay, it's n equal 1, then I don't, and then you are entering this insulating phase. The same as here. So this is really the meaning of the mod. You see, adding some one particle, so instead of n over n, in the limit of infinite system, n going to infinity, n going to infinity, gives you, and if you add one particle, you see the ground state energy changes by this. Okay? So it is, even for infinite system, adding one particle costs some finite energy to the system. Because I will add n plus 1, n is going to infinity, m is going to infinity, n over m is n, and now I am adding one particle, and energy of the system, you see, jumps from here to here for this j. So it really shows that this is really totally different phase. Adding one particle to the system makes a non-continuous change in chemical potential. It shows that the system is not compressible, etc. So this is the meaning of this phase diagram. So everywhere when you have not integer filling, you have superfluid. You have some particles jumping back and forth. However, when you add this particle, for sufficiently small, large, because when you go to large and large view, you don't have, but this is in fact for medium vision. This is this mod insulator which is can be entered only for integer number of particles. So this is the phase diagram, and you know, mean field calculations, you know, people are struggling with getting proper position of the tips. Of course, mean field works much better in higher dimensions than in lower dimensions, and then there are different methods to get it very precisely, etc. To complicate this model, to add dipolar interactions, to get near, next near neighbor hopping and other hoppings, and etc., etc. You have plenty of different possibilities, plenty of models, exotic phases recently even observed. I would say it's super solid phase with dipolar interactions, for instance. So rich field of physics started in 2002 till now with this experiment. And this is, for instance, there was another thing that I didn't mention, how to create a real magnetic field for atoms. Because in this lattice, what people in solid state do, like Hall effect, etc., they use magnetic fields. But for atoms, magnetic field is responsible for Zeeman shift only, not like for charged particle where it gives the Lorentz force. So how to create a Lorentz force? And then people invented different kind of Floquet engineering to Hamiltonian. So going to time-dependent Hamiltonian and not inertial frames, because we know that this Coriolis force and something like Lorentz force appears in non-inertial frames. So going to different non-inertial lattices. You shake the lattices by shaking the laser beams using Augusto optical modulators, etc., producing different kind of magnetic fields, artificial models with non-trivial topologies, etc. This is also the domain of ultra-cold gases. And at the end, I want to give some conclusions, because everything is being done here, it is just research, curiosity-driven research. Okay. Now people very often ask about applications, and physicists are trying to invent different applications like quantum computers, quantum simulators. Quantum simulators may be okay. I hardly see quantum computers made of atoms in a vacuum, in a vacuum chamber with vacuum pumps that you keep in your pocket and you use it instead of your cell phone. However, this basic research is also important, and it's very important for us to do the basic research, to explain it to public that this is also something which should be financed. That they, in this running for, I don't know, application, they shouldn't stop it. And here I will repeat after
Klaus Molmer some discussion, which was on April 17, 1969. It was the Fermi Lab director Robert Wilson, who was testified in front of the Congress Jones Committee of Atomic Energy, and this is the conversation. Senator Pastor, is there anything connected in the hopes of this accelerator that in any way involves the security of the country? It was just to finance the accelerator. Dr. Wilson, no sir, I don't believe so. Nothing at all? It has no value in that respect? Dr. Wilson, it only has to do with the respect with which we together, we regard one another. The dignity of man, our love of culture, it has to do with those things. It has nothing to do with the military. In that sense, this knowledge has all to do with honor and country, but it has nothing to do directly with defending our country, except to help make it worth defending. So with this I will finish this lecture showing that some basic science shouldn't be totally neglected. So, that's all. And